Welcome, buenas noches. Good evening, everybody. Welcome to the Library and Archives of the Center for Puerto Rican Studies. Bienvenidos. Mi nombre es Alberto Hernandez. I'm the librarian and archivist, the new librarian and archivist at the Centro. Of course, we're a public general, open to the public at all times when the library is open. Researchers, students, people in the community. We want to transform the Centro as a platform for information on Puerto Ricans and Puerto Rico. We'll be moving in the next 3 years, we'll be moving to East Harlem. And we're very excited about that. First of all, I want to thank everybody for being here, especially to our guests, distinguished guests, Ms. Miriam Colón, and of course, Eva Vásquez. More sincere thanks for the willingness to be here tonight with us and share their experiences with us. And I would also like to take the opportunity and thank Mrs. Miriam Colón for the donation of the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater papers that she's going to be, she's willing to, we're negotiating that right now. But we're very proud of that. And her collection will definitely start interest in collecting theater in USA and Puerto Rican theater in the future. Our director of the center, Dr. Edwin Melendez, is in Puerto Rico. He's at a conference, so he cannot be here, but he'll, of course, extend his welcome. Ms. Virginia Sánchez-Korrol is our moderator for tonight's Legacy Series event. This show still goes on.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, and thank you all for your patience. The theater always begins a little bit later than it's supposed to, so we wanted to put you into the mood of tonight. I was very, very busy before talking to Eva and to Miriam, our honored guests for this evening, about some of the things that I wanted to do before we got into our conversation. And what I would like to do is to, first of all, to welcome you and to tell you that the format for tonight, we're striving for an intimate setting. That's why it's here in the library. And we are going to engage in a conversation. And once we're ready to open it up to the public, we'll let you in on this conversation with us. So at first you'll be listening and observing, and we have these wonderful, wonderful pictures in the background so that you are also visually stimulated as well as intellectually stimulated with the story of the theater. Did you know that Puerto Rican, New York theater begins in the 19th century? This is something that not many, many people are aware of, but theater has always been a very, very important part of the Puerto Rican community. And in the 1890s, when the Cuban and Puerto Rican community began to establish settlements in New York City, theater was part of the culture that they brought with them and that they helped to develop. Now, one of the things about New York and the Latino community was that it was very, very diverse. And this was something that was not happening in the rest of the country. In the Southwest, it was predominantly Mexican. And in other parts of the United States, it would be predominantly one ethnic group or another. But New York was very, very diverse. And so the way the theater operated was with Cubans and Dominicans and Puerto Rican actors and Spaniards and Mexicans. And they would form companies. And these dramatic compañías teatrales, and these dramatic companies would hire out theaters and places where they could present their work. Now, what were they doing? They were presenting productions of zarzuela, which was very, very important in the Spanish-speaking theater. And a zarzuela was like a light opera and was comedic. They were also presenting melodramas. And they were presenting pretty soon. They got into more serious theater and they started to present serious drama, not just melodrama. Comedies were very, very important, and particularly with a style of comedy called el teatro bufo, which was La Bufa Cubana, which was blackface. And that was a very, very important part of the, it was satirical. So that in presenting una obra Bufa Cubana, you would be presenting a political satire or a satire on the government or anything like that. The places where Spanish-speaking theater took place were like Park Theater, Amsterdam Opera House, the Leslie Theater, Carnegie Hall was a big one. And what the companies would do is that they would hire them out. Teatros of movie houses and theaters, like El Campo Amor, which then became El Teatro Hispano, coming into the beginning of the 20th century, was one of the first places to present vaudeville. So that dance was very important. Musicals were very, very important. And this is what the audience came to see. So what's interesting about this is that we already have an audience, an appreciative theater-going audience in New York City as early as the 1890s, and that it continues into the decades before the Second World War. Puerto Ricans, particularly in the 1920s, when the community of Puerto Ricans began to grow, and they began to become the largest of the Latino ethnic groups, were very much involved in political dramas. They would write plays about nationalism, about socialism. They would write plays against the government of Puerto Rico, against the colonial government. With a number of the very, very earliest playwrights were people like José Enamorado Cuesta, who presented in 1937 a play called El Pueblo en Marcha. Franca de Armiño, one of the few women who was a playwright at this time and whose work we know about, wrote a play called Los Hipócritas, The Hypocrites, which was staged in 1933 at the Park Palace. Gonzalo O'Neill presented La Indiana Borincana, Borinqueña, in 1922, Moncho Reyes in 1923, Bajo Una Sola Bandera, which was a very, very important play, seemed to have attracted a huge audience because it was played often. It was produced often on the stage. And Amorios Borincano in 1938. So by that early period, we have now a serious dramatic theater that is Spanish speaking, that is dominated now by Puerto Ricans. We have also the dances and the musicals. And we have the beginning of also the showing of motion pictures, so that it was not unusual on a Sunday afternoon for a Puerto Rican family to go to El Teatro Hispano and to sit through two movies, one of which may have been Argentinian and one may have been Mexican, and a vaudeville show, and to also collect dishes, which they would give out, and prizes for coming to the theaters. So this was a very, very common experience for a Puerto Rican family. Anita Vélez-Mitchell enters the theatrical world at this time. And she cannot be here tonight because she took sick and she's under doctor's orders not to leave the house, although I understand she had to be tied down. But we have a film clip by Claire Pankey, who is with us today. And she is doing a documentary on Anita. And so to sort of historically get the picture of where she, who will be 93 years old tomorrow, where she begins her theatrical career, and then to bring it up to the present, here we have it.
I see, so to speak, the Vietnam and Puerto Rico.
So Anita not only goes on to become a movie actress and to act on television and television commercials, she goes on to become an actress on Broadway and plays the role of Anita in West Side Story. She does a number of films, and after exhausting all aspects of the theater, she begins to write and becomes an award-winning writer, writing collections of poetry and writing plays and producing plays and appearing before the United Nations several times because she wanted to protest the U.S. involvement in Vieques, which is the place where she was born, or recently in Puerto Rico because she wanted to protest with her daughter Jane Vélez-Mitchell the abuse of stray dogs. And this is an activist who gives her energy to what we continue to do in our work in the theater, or in the writing and researching of history or literature, and these are the people that hand us the legacies that we then will develop. So we're going to now go into our conversation for the evening with our two illustrious guests. And Miriam, you're recognized as a talented and gifted actress in film, television, and on the stage. You began your career at the University of Puerto Rico in the theater department, and in New York studied at the dramatic workshop and at Actor Studio. In 1967, you did something that will always be a legacy to our community. You founded the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater to take the theater to the people in the city's poorest neighborhoods. Today, the theater not only offers Class A productions, but offers acting classes and improvisations and a playwrights unit, and is considered one of the premier institutions of the city of New York, Puerto Rican contribution to the city of New York. Since 1950s, you've performed in countless roles in films and television and theater that brought you national and international acclaim. Among these roles are Almost a Woman, it's my favorite, Lone Star, A Life of Sin, The Outsider, One-Eyed Jacks, and I understand from an interview that you gave that young people meet you on the subway platforms and they say, is it her? Is it really her? Yes, it's Mama Montana from Scarface, because this has become a cult movie. You've received honorary doctorates from Montclair State College, St. Peter's College, Marymount Manhattan College, Rutgers University, and one which we're very proud of, the Presidential Medal from Brooklyn College. We're delighted to have you here, Dr. Colón. Eva Cristina Vásquez, you received your doctorate in theater from the City University of New York in 2001. And Routledge published your research in 2003. entitled Pregones Theater, a theater for social change in the South Bronx. You're currently assistant professor in the Spanish department at York College and a founding member of Teatro Círculo. In 2002, you authored Amor Perdido, your first one-woman show, and I think we have some scenes from that. In 2007, you received the Ola Award for Outstanding Solo Performance in Lágrimas Negras, Tribulaciones de una Negrita Acomplejada. That work has also received the ACE Award for Extraordinary Theater Award in 2008, just recently. You're now an associate professor. And this work is now under revision for publication, so congratulations, Dr. Vásquez. I think one of the things that really interests us is that, what was it that motivated you to dedicate your life to the performing arts? Was it a person, was it a thing, or an event? How did you get into this business? Because it's not an easy business.
Well, I didn't know I was getting into show business. I was led as a young girl in school, mostly teachers, and a girl with really no direction as to what I was going to be. I didn't know what I was going to be. But I had a wonderful mother, and she would allow me, if I was involved in a project in school, she would not hold me back, she would not threaten me. She was supportive. And she also offered a very, very strong type of support and assurance to me. But she was not the kind of mother that, you know, she has a plan for her daughter and she knows exactly in what college she's going to push her and what she would like to really work to help her become. There was none of that. But there was this quality of being part of me and being my friend. That was very, very important. So it was mostly teachers and in school. I remember the first time that I auditioned for a play. I didn't know what audition was. Just the girls were going to a room there, and one of them said, mira, van a leer gente allí para una obrita, y entonces si quiere puede venir a leer con nosotros. I followed. I sort of was curious about it, and I read for one of the roles in junior high, and they gave me the role of a young woman. I had never acted or anything like that, but it was the beginning, and it had this sort of accidental kind of nature to it, and it's just that the first experience was so wonderful that I wanted to continue, and I kept asking when was going to be the next play, etc. And there was going to be only just one play. So at the end, I had no direction. But it was this way how I awoken to the possibility of maybe acting or doing something like that. And it was slow, and it was sort of innocent. I liked doing that. It gave me great satisfaction. And before I realized it, I was up to here in that. That's all I wanted to do. And it was a slow immersion on something that I enjoyed doing it. And then I suddenly realized, gee, but it took my entire life. this is becoming my life. I was not going to make a commitment like that. I was just in the middle of it. and I enjoyed every moment of it.
So, when you went to that audition and you got the part, was it the creating of a character, or was it the fact that there was an audience, or what was it that gave you that feeling, this is what I want to do?
Well, it was slow. It was very, very slow. I sort of went deeper and deeper and deeper in it, and all of a sudden, I had no other hobbies. I had no other activities, and I don't resent it. It's just that I was deriving great satisfaction from it. I was learning, and that's what I felt satisfaction doing it. And then I became curious about learning more. I started learning all about the good schools and about how you can graduate from that, and I learned that there are, you know, schools for advanced studies that you could come to New York and study here. Then I heard about the Actors Studio, and little by little I kept going close to that and close to that, and then I did become a member of the Actors Studio. And later on, with my identifying with the theatrical movement in New York, then I realized that I enjoyed that very much, although supposedly I came here to study the theater in English. I had done plenty of theater in Spanish in Puerto Rico. But the integration of the Spanish with the English was also slow. And then later on came the part where I said, wait a minute, can't we put the play ourselves? Can't we, get the plays ourselves? And I was never going to dream that I was going to become a producer and that I was going to have a company, and that there was going to be the creation of something called the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater. It was all slow. It was just one step after the other, and pretty soon we were there, and there was something called Puerto Rican Traveling Theater, and I love it. And it also was a slow process because I was behind the idea of the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater, but it took thousands of people to make it a reality. I didn't do it myself.
We never do it ourselves. It takes a village.
Many people.
How did you do it? Who motivated you to?
I guess many different things. My grandmother, who was from the countryside of Puerto Rico, and then she moved to what used to be called El Fanguito, always wanted to be a cabaret dancer. She never was, but she always wanted to. And she had that kind of spirit that was very dramatic. And ever since I was a little kid, my mother was always saying things like, ah, ahí viene la actriz de la familia. Otro drama de Vita. So at some point I believed it and I said, okay, so maybe that's what I want to do. And then my mother said, if you want to be a theater person, you have to study for it. It's not going to be like you're going to just try to do it. You have to have several degrees, and she didn't let go until I finished a PhD. So I guess that I always had the support of my family, the support of my friends, the support of my classmates, and everybody said, yes, this is what you need to do. So I always trusted that was gonna happen. When I came to New York, though, I didn't come to New York. To begin with, I didn't come to New York to stay. I didn't want to come. I got a scholarship. I came as a CUNY UPR Academic Exchange student. They told me probably 2 weeks before I had to be here. I bought everything black and gray, like my coat, my suitcases, my clothes, everything. And I was convinced that I was going to come here, have probably a depression or a panic attack, go back home and say to my mother, yes, you see, you told me to do it, I went and it didn't work, but I stayed and it's been 20 years. And yeah, other depressions, not that one. But they always supported me, and I remember my grandparents taking money out of their social security checks so that I could have some extra money to do whatever I needed to do. And I came to study developmental theater, and it was a pretty academic, straightforward thing. It was about reading and writing and working with community theater. But what happened was that as part of the CUNY UPR Academic Exchange Program, we got tickets to go to different places. So a year within my my arrival in New York, we went to Pregones Theater. We got tickets to go to Pregones. And I saw the company acting. It was, the play was Migrants. And it was a play about Puerto Ricans and the history of Puerto Ricans as migrants in New York. And I was sitting there and I was like, I'm not doing the right thing. I don't wanna be part of the audience, I wanna be there. So, but I let it go. All of a sudden, there was Paulette Beauchamp, who was doing a choreography for Medea, said they are needing an actress. And I said, okay, so maybe I'll go. And I went, and that was my first theater home in New York. And I also got their support, and all of a sudden what happened was what always happens. You go to the University of Puerto Rico, you don't find a job, you come to New York, and people start regrouping. So many of the people who studied with me and went to other places to do masters and PhDs ended up in New York. And all of a sudden we were either homeless together or eating out of the same plate or moving around together and trying to find jobs together. And many of the things that we found either didn't satisfy us or we wanted more. So we ended up forming our own group. And as I said, I go back to Puerto Rico every year 2-3 times, but I stayed. And we realized that it was important also to stay. It was important to go back, and it was also important to stay. So they have been my family in New York, my supporters. I've been working with different companies. We work for the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater into summer tours. We have worked for Thalia. I work for Repertorio Español, and now we have our company. And I guess it's the same thing. It's like you get the support of the people. People start throwing projects at you, and you embrace them, and you develop them.
So pretty much what was happening in New York Puerto Rican theater at the time that you came was this need to find, you're finding each other, but you weren't getting that in Puerto Rico.
I had seen one Cynthia. I have seen one production of the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater back in Puerto Rico. I believe it was probably in 1988, it was Bodega. But it was the only exposure that I ever had to New York theater, New York Puerto Rican theater back in Puerto Rico. I didn't come with the idea of, okay, I'm gonna go and knock on their door and tell them, I'm here, do something with me. It took time and courage, and I had a lot to do. I was studying, and I didn't know English. So I was going to a graduate program, trying to figure out the English, trying to figure out the readings, 300-400 pages a week, with my dictionary, crying. I just saw Cynthia here, and she was the one who welcomed us when we came to New York. Running to her office and asking for help, and can you please proofread this paper, this and that. And all of a sudden, I was working in theater, which was great because it probably held me here longer. At any given point, I could have said, okay, I'm not going to write anything else. This is too difficult. I'm going to go back to Puerto Rico. And then I started using theater as an excuse not to finish my master and my PhD, and using the PhD and the master's not to do enough theater. And both things happened at the same time, so I guess I stayed.
Miriam, what was happening in the Puerto Rican community regarding theater when you came? What What was it like?
There was a few things. I remember Roberto Rodriguez Suarez, may he rest in peace. He was struggling. In fact, it was, I've said this so many times, I am embarrassed to say it again, but it's the truth. I had just arrived from Puerto Rico to study at the dramatic workshop, and he found out somehow, and he went to the dramatic workshop and technical institute, and they told me, there's a young man there that wants to see you, and he says from Puerto Rico, etc. So I came out, and there was this young man there. I didn't know Roberto from before. And he told me that he was working here in New York. He was a Puerto Rican director and author. And I said, what plays have you directed? And he told me, well, I have directed La Muela del Rey Farfán. And I have directed, tell me another title. And so I don't know La Muela del Rey Farfán. So I didn't know what kind of a play was that. Anyway, he said, the reason I came to see you is because I know you're an actress, and there is a play that I have here. And he pulled out a little pamphlet like this, very thin, and he said, it came published in a play in Puerto Rico, and it's called La Carreta, and I want to produce it. And I am going to be the director and the producer, and I was wondering if I may interest you in the role of the daughter. I said, oh, well, I was just sent here to do theater in English. And I did a lot of Spanish theater in Puerto Rico, but I was sent here to do theater in English. And I was very condescending. And so I said, but just please leave me the little play, the play, and I will try to read it, etc. Well, what happened was that night I read it and I flipped. I went crazy when I realized what the play was all about. And the next morning I was desperate looking for Roberto Rodriguez Suarez. And that started a friendship that lasted many, many, many years. We became friends and we did plays together, and we would fight and then reconcile and this and that. And it lasted for many, many years. But that's how we started. And it was actually this man, one of the few that were here at the time, with his own money, with his own salary, with his own rent, he presented La Carreta in the basement of a church on the east side, and I can't remember the name of the church, but there's documents and pictures, and René came. He flew here. Anyway, this is how it started. But it was people like Roberto Rodriguez and others that with their own means would take a chance and present plays that they liked, etc. And it took some time for me to start realizing that there were others. There was La Farándula Panamericana, who was a group of Puerto Ricans and Latin American people here that were presenting plays before I came, and they had their own company, and they had their own capital, and their own, and the productions were good. I remember maybe I saw two. And there were women like Marita Reed, who had her own company prior to our arriving in the city. And so I started sensing that the theatrical movement in Latino theater was very much a reality, although with very, very limited economic means.
How did you reconcile that with the fact that you were a student at the dramatic workshop? I mean, were they pleased that you were doing theater?
Yeah, they really did not try to control my life or what I could give my time or what project. It was not the kind of a school that is like a conservatory and they're watching every minute and they schedule your time. No, it was more loose. And it was very pleasant, and so I felt that there would be no conflict in acting in Spanish. I liked acting in Spanish. Then I started meeting a lot of other actors and finding out about other playwrights, etc. So it just went smoothly from one language to the other, and. Then, you know, until today that we have so many groups like Repertorio Español, Antalía, and Pregones, and there's so many of them that are a reality now and that involve a great number of people and technicians.
How did you start then acting in English language films? How did that come about?
That was not really in the plan to be in films. I don't recall that as a child I was like somehow dreaming of one day being a Hollywood star and stardom and things like that and romance. And I was mostly interested in the theater. That's what I knew. And when I went to Hollywood to work in a little play there, it was that they saw me in New York in a play called Mi Cándido. And then it was Rafael Campos, brother of Fernando Campos, one of the founders of La ACE. And Rafael was very big at that time because he was, he had done Black Boy Jungle, I mean, all the little girls, you know, legions of little girls and pretty girls after Rafael Campos, I remember that. And
remember Black Boy Jungle.
Yeah, yeah.
That's scary.
So when he saw the play there called Mi Cándido, he decided that he was right for Cándido. And I had done the play in New York with Jose Perez, so therefore, because he was very influential and very, very popular, he immediately got a producer there to produce Mi Cándido, where he played the role of Cándido. And then he spoke to the director about me and said that there was a girl that had done the part of his sister, and would he be interested in auditioning her? And he says, what if he says he wants you? I said, well, if he says he wants me, I have to go. Anyway, it was a long story, but he did speak to the director, and the director had a small theater. I mean, think of the smallest theater that we have in New York. That theater was smaller. And then the director, he showed my pictures and my reviews, and the director said, well, if she would fly herself here, pay her transportation, and would she be willing to work for $50 a week? Yes, we will, because, and I was in seventh heaven. I immediately took the plane, and I wound up in Hollywood. Rafael used to live in the house of an Italian woman with daughters, and the house was always full of people. So he got me a small room, like como una abonada. Abonada, yo no sé cómo se dice en inglés.
Studio?
I paid by the week, yeah. I paid by the week, but I had but we all owned like the living room and the kitchen because the woman was enchanted to have Rafael Campos there and to have actors and young people entering and gorgeous girls and photographers and all that. So we were like the owners of the house. And this is how I came to Hollywood. When I did the play, then about, I don't know, 50 agents saw me, and then I started working constantly in television and things like that. But what caused it was to come to do that little play.
Well, very often those are the things that give you the power to go ahead and do something that you really have your heart set on doing. So I was wondering, what do both of you consider at this point your most, after struggling with language, you know, going out to California to do films, what do you consider, like if you had to, you're giving your papers to the Centro, and all these students are going to be using them for research and writing books. What is your greatest accomplishment? And why do you consider that your greatest accomplishment?
I don't know if this would be my greatest accomplishment.
You still have more to accomplish.
I think it's too early to figure out what would be my greatest accomplishment. But there are little steps that have become important accomplishments. To me, getting my dissertation published and making it available for other people who need to research the theater, it was very important. I didn't realize. I remember the day that I had to print the 4 copies that are going to go to the school, and I carried them, and I was wearing beautiful heels, and I was very well dressed, and I carried the whole thing, and I was the only person there, of course, but I thought that there was gonna be a group of people waiting for that dissertation, and I was so flirtatious with my whole package that even covered my face. And the lady took them and threw them to the side, and I was like, oh there it goes. And it only took 10 seconds to see it disappear. So when I was contacted to get it published, and I had to work very hard on that, because for many reasons. I was lucky enough to have Gloria Waldman look over the English, and she even made me pay for somebody to look it up, and then she said, I don't like it. And I had spent everything I had in my bank account to get it proofread. She said, I'm going to do it myself. And then I had a lot of support from the people from Pregones Theater, who gave me everything they had. They opened their files so that I could look and look at pictures and put together material and interview them. It was very important for me to see it somewhere, so that was one accomplishment. It doesn't have anything to do with acting. But what I came to realize was that one thing that we are missing if we want the show to go on is that we really need to document what has happened. And theater is an extremely ephemeral thing. It's like you put together the show, you show the show, and the show disappears. And if people don't keep the programs and interviews and the history of whatever company is doing it, we lose it. So even when I was looking over the scripts that were the product of collective creation, some of those scripts were missing pages. And they only had one copy that was typed, and part of the copy was on the top drawer. The other part was on the lower drawer, and the other parts I had to figure out and come to El Centro and see, okay, they were doing a collage of such and such and such play, and this page finishes here, maybe this is the following page. So I thought that, to me, that was an important accomplishment. I didn't make any money out of it. But I thought it was important to...
I told you would not make any money at the first
one. And that was okay, because it got me my tenure, so... But, and I wasn't expecting to make any money, so... But what I'm trying to say is that you don't measure accomplishments with awards and money. You measure them differently. Also, when I was able to write 2 one-woman shows, and to me, theater is pretty much, I guess, as an actress or an actor, as they say now, is much more about process than about the product. The product is very important. The product is what you show. The product is what the audience sees. But the process, to me, is what really makes you grow, and it's what really makes you search for more or say, okay, this doesn't work. Of course, when the process gets to the audience, you figure out whether or not it works or not. But having the opportunity of getting two shows produced have been two very important achievements for me. And getting the trust of people, I never dared to say, but I even sang a zarzuela, and I don't trust myself singing Happy Birthday. And they hired me to sing a zarzuela, and seeing that people would trust me, whether I trusted myself or not, and saying, okay, so I need the job. I like to do this, let's try it. And the other thing to me was going back to Puerto Rico after 18 years of not performing there, and being able to be part of the of one of the Institute of Puerto Rican Culture festivals. And it was very interesting because this is a very small achievement, it's extremely personal, but when I saw my grandmother, who at the time was 90 years old, jumping up and down, I knew that she didn't understand the play, and she told us, okay, nice to see you, but I didn't get it. And I felt, oh my God, I have two homes. I have one home in New York and one home back in Puerto Rico. That to me was an achievement because throughout the time that I worked with Pregones had never been to Puerto Rico with a play until pretty recently. What year was it? Do you remember?
90s.
And I had seen the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater there, but only once. And I don't know if you had been there more afterwards. And we were taking a chance. I mean, it's interesting when you leave Puerto Rico, people believe that you are no longer Puerto Rican. It's a weird thing. It's like you don't belong. Now you are part of the New York scene. Although I grew up in Puerto Rico, I went to the University of Puerto Rico, and whenever I go back to Puerto Rico, I clean my mother's house. So that makes me very much Puerto Rican because I'm not a tourist in Puerto Rico. I have a domestic life in Puerto Rico, but somehow the two worlds are so detached that going back to Puerto Rico and claiming a space and now having a relationship with the Institute of Puerto Rican Culture, for a small company like ours with a very limited budget, is a huge thing. Also, we acquired a building, and that's one of the things that not many of us had then, but now we do. Pregones has its own theater house, the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater has its house, and now we have a building that we have to renovate. That's a huge achievement, because we used to rent space. We used to take over things. Like, I remember our first pictures, the costumes, and I should probably don't confess this, were costumes that we saw misplaced in other places, and we said, okay, we are gonna borrow this with that, and somebody's gonna take a look at it, and if it makes sense, we are gonna use it. But we didn't even have the money to buy costumes, and we didn't have the money to rent spaces. So now we have a huge responsibility. So those are humble achievements, but yeah.
Sound pretty good to me. Miriam, what would you say?
I would say that this anguish, this desperation for survival, you experience at that early phase of your development. And I am sorry to inform you that in the case of the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater, 41 years later, it's the same anguish. The fight for survival, the fear, the constant anguish, the always being at the tail end of the priorities when it comes to funding, the having to convince people that the legacy of theater is a wonderful gift that we can give this nation. It's a wonderful document that we can leave for generations to come. theater for us among each other in these hard times. Theater can contribute so much to our understanding what is going on, to our understanding our neighbor, to our sometimes understanding ourselves. And I am sold out on the idea of theater, but I suffer. I am sad. I am constantly saddened by the thought of, oh my God, we could collapse tomorrow. Because even after 41 years, we have not achieved the economic works in our infrastructure that is shockproof against economic collapsing. And there's so much to be done. There's so much to be gained. There's so much to be conquered in terms of making our own community respect and understand that they have to support their own cultural institutions. We cannot continue to depend on the Americanos to bring it and to invent it so that we can do it. We have to do it ourselves. And what else could we contribute to the world of theater here, the capital of theater in the world? But how much more are they continue repeating Gypsy and Phantom of the Opera and 42nd Street and all that, unless we continue bringing works to it and trying to discover playwrights and trying to give an opportunity to playwrights, to the women, to the men, we're not going to have a legacy. We cannot become dependent on what is happening in the theater. We have to search for our own playwrights. We have to celebrate our own playwrights. And in the case of the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater, it's not just the Puerto Ricans. We have presented the Cubans, the Dominicans, the Venezuelan, the Argentinian, the Colombian, the Spanish ones, because in the element of theater, it's what comes from here and what comes from here, what is important. Yes, our theater is the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater, and I want to continue to defend the essence of that theater. I want that pride. I want that name, but the theater is open to Cubans and Venezuelans and Dominicans and Argentinians and Spaniards and everybody, because I feel together we have a larger scope.
That also corresponds to the reality of New York. New York is not only Puerto Ricans. New York is people from everywhere who are coming to your door and knocking on the door saying, I have a degree in theater, I want to do work, and we have to embrace everybody, and that means the plays that we produce, the new plays that we... Producing a new play is a huge chance, because when you're producing a classic, at least you could try to knock on the doors of professors who might be teaching it and tell them, okay, bring your students to the theater. But when you're producing something that is new with somebody who's not a star, it's a huge, huge risk. It's an economic risk. It's like you need a lot of money to produce the play, and probably people are not gonna come. So what happens many times is that we have a play in which we have 8 people in the cast and 4 people in the audience. So if we fight with them, we win. That's an awful situation. It's a very difficult way of producing theater. You still have to do it, because if you lose those 4, come on, 4 could bring 2 more next time. You never know. I agree with you. It's a huge anguish, and especially now that the budgets have been cut by half, by 40%, 30%, many groups might disappear. So it's, yes, we don't sleep well. We don't know where the money is gonna come. We don't make money out of this. In our company, everybody has a full-time job that is not the theater. And everybody works full-time so that the theater is still alive. That's what we have to do. I mean, and on the other hand, I have to say that there are some other groups and the people involved in these companies that have done a beautiful advocacy work so that we also get money. Even if it is a little bit of money, they talk for us, they put a case for us, they present the case, they defend it, and we get a little bit of money, and we make do with whatever little money we have. Renovating a theater is a nightmare. we had a huge illusion when we got the space, and every time you pull a nail, there's another violation that requires a different contractor because the money that you got wouldn't be covered, and you have to hire the other person. So it becomes a nightmare. But in the end, we hope that that's gonna be there for the people who come after us. As we got a lot from the people who came before us. We got a lot from the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater. I learned a huge lot from Pregone Theater by seeing them work, by interviewing them, by working with them. Even when I was in disagreement with many of the things that were going there, and I was 22, what can I say? I thought that I knew everything. But then I go back and sometimes we have meetings and I say, I remember that Pregones Theater used to do it this way and it worked for them. And they are there and they have their building. So there's something we have to learn from them. But yes, it's an anguish.
I've learned a lot from Pregones. They happen to be my friends. I remember when Rosalba told me one day, Miriam, you have to come with me to the Bronx because I'm gonna take you to the place where we're gonna buy the building. And it's a small space there also that is called the White House. And we're gonna start there. And then next to it is the building. And so I went with her. And when we stood in front of this building, there was this flat building there with bricks. And no windows, and it looked old and dilapidated. And I said, Rosalba, this is the building? And she said, oh yes, the entrance is gonna be here, you see, and there's gonna be a banner here, and you see the next door and this and that, and downstairs will be where we build the sets. And then here, in this part right here, will be the lobby and this and that. And she gave me a tour of the thing. And I felt like, better not express what I am sensing, because I had gone through the experience of rebuilding the building where we are, which is not ours, belongs to the city of New York. But I wouldn't do that again for all the gold in China. I can't. It's very, 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 very hard. And when I heard Rosalba with such energy and with such joy, I felt a little bit weak in my heart. And I said, better not say anything because, you know. And that building, I hope all of you have gone to see that. It's a gorgeous theater in the middle of this, you know, depressed neighborhood, 2 minutes away from Astor's College. A gorgeous, gorgeous building that will also have a garden and all that. And there are downstairs the building quarters for building and storage. And there's a beautiful theater in the top floor, and the beautiful lobby, which also doubles as a gallery, and this and that. So you see, miracles are possible, and I have seen it with my own eyes. But I know what they're going through, and they are enormously successful. But it's a beautiful example about that reality, that if you like it and you believe it, go ahead.
You have to
go ahead.
I remember two pregón spaces back, which is the one that I started working at, and I remember getting off the train, and I mean, it was a beautiful space in St. Anne's Church, but it was a very dangerous area. So I knew if I could walk to work from the train station on Brook Avenue to the theater, if I heard people saying, Tato, Tato, and I was like, who the hell is Tato? Because I didn't know what it meant. But I remember one time we had to, you know, go on the floor because they were shooting around the area. And I was like, oh my God, this is, then again, I was younger than I am today. And it felt dangerous. And it's like hurricane season in Puerto Rico when you're a child. Yeah. You know that something dangerous is coming, but it might be somehow fun because you skip classes. This was a new experience for me, and it was somehow interesting because I never had it. But seeing the company grow from that kind of environment to another kind of environment that is their own, that is more controlled, is a huge thing because also it makes more people go there. And I remember inviting people to the place that I was doing at Pregones, and they would go like, is the area dangerous? And I was like, no.
No,
no, not at all. I go. But it was dangerous. And it was a deterrent for many people. And it was an interesting contrast between trying to do culture inside a theater and what was going on around that theater and who was the audience. And the people who were drug dealing were not the audience. Still, we had to deal with it. And I appreciate having done that because now I see their building, I see our building, and I'm like, ah, this is nothing. I mean, they worked very hard so that we could get here. And I appreciate it totally.
Is there a future?
Of course there's a future. Yes. It might get slower. It's very contingent to budget. It's contingent to the support of the audience. But of course there's a future. Yes. People come and go. Younger people come with new hopes. And they find what they find, and they take what they can take. They discard what they need to discard, and they do their own thing. Of course, there's a future.
A positive note that I have noticed when we talk about authors, our group's taking chances with the unknown. If you do a Lorca play, you will automatically have $20,000 worth of college students coming, colleges coming to see Lorca. But if you do Federico Fraguada, like I was confronted one day, and they said, pero Miriam, what are you doing? What are you doing? Who is Federico Fraguada? Who is, you know, like the guy who wrote La Calle Simpson? I said, well, we have an obligation to give the voices of this generation, because they are writing a very important chapter of our development as people in this country. They are writing it, and if we don't write it, it's gonna be written by other people that don't know us as well, and may come up with another Children of Sánchez or another West Side Story. We have to write it, and a curious thing, but it warms my heart, is that when plays like La Carreta cannot be used in those examples because La Carreta was a special happening, what happened with La Carreta, and it beat all records and it will continue to beat the records. But when we presented of the place that we chose to take that to Puerto Rico, a curious thing with the audiences in New York. If it is something of a subject that they like, that they recognize the characters, that they recognize
the circumstances and the dilemma, they love it. There is absolutely nothing to do whether those plays are published, how many theses have been written about them, how many colleges in the United States use them as text. If they are touched and they are there's some recognition there. The Latino people, and especially the Puerto Ricans, because this I confirm with a few other things in my own theater, they like it, they come back. They pay again. They bring the girlfriend of their son, they bring the women from the office, they bring their comadre, they bring the neighbors. This is amazing what the Latino people do. And I have seen this in my theater. It happened with La Lupe, and it happened with La Calle Simpson. Everybody said to me in the subway, I was born in La Calle Simpson. I was raised in La Calle Simpson. It was a strange thing of recognition that they were. But the wonderful and hopeful thing is that the Latino people like the theater. This is why I have hope, and this is why I say there is hope, because those people, and with others that I know are going to join, are going to continue to nurture the idea of going to the theater as a part of our lives, to bring their children as a part of their life, not waiting till they are 18, to then take them, drag them to see a play, but bring them when they are young, where they can yet start appreciating that, and they will be, because these theaters is what we're leaving for them. Is what we have created for them, and for them to continue and to nurture.
Let's open it up to you guys. You can speak from where you are, as long as you stand, or you can take one of the microphones. Don't all raise your hands at the same time.
It's like a classroom.
I can't help to think that through all your years of struggle, has there ever been a time where you said, "Al diablo con todo esto, I can't take it anymore," and actually walked out and come back to it? Of course.
I have not walked out.
No.
But I am very aware that I cannot give this theater 40 more years. We have to find the people that are going to take responsibility for it. And all I hope is that when we choose, and I've been for 3 or 4 years quietly watching around, to see who I would consider that would have the seriousness and the dedication. All I hope to God is that we do the right choosing, and that they will not betray the whole idea of having a Puerto Rican traveling theater, and that they will not betray the mission, and that they will not betray the commitment to those people, to the commitment to using the theater as part of our culture, as part of our expression. And yes, I've had moments where I have felt that I am scared, I can't do it anymore. So it is my obligation to continue to look for these people that love the idea, that understand how important it is for us to leave that and to nurture it for our children, but also not only for our children, for the nation to learn. I don't know that you can consider yourself a sophisticated theater goer, a man or woman of the theater, if you don't know who Emilio Carballido is, or Isaac Chocron,
or René Marquez. So they will have to start learning some of the richness that we have, and hopefully we will be able to leave this as a lesson and as a continued cultivation, because it's very rich and it's very deep.
But Miriam, that those, one of the things that happened is precisely that, because you remember that in 1963 we started in TAR. Right, it was on 58th and 9th Avenue, and then we moved to 42nd. What happened? There were seven, four Puerto Ricans and three Cubans. One by one, they started leaving. Finally, there was only Max, Frank, and myself. And I also left, and Frank also left. Then it was Max, and he somehow kept it in there for a few years. Now he's retired, he's in Miami, and I don't even know who has a theater now.
Right.
So, you know, it's like, it's very difficult to find people that would really, really stick to that and that would make it grow and make it an institution. And sometimes it's that, you know, the work is too much and you give up, or maybe the conflicts between the people, you know, that are, and then you say, why should I be fighting with Max all the time, because he always makes the productions. He has a budget and he always goes over the budget, and then I was looking for the money. I would say, you can't, you don't have the money. And he would still do it and go over budget, and then finally you just get tired.
Right.
So
that's difficult. I think that is also not so much the fault of the people involved. I feel that there's gotta be more abundance that is shared with us, so that we can have our cultural gifts and product survive. It should not all be the sacrifice of a group of people that use their salary to help pay for the rent and to help for the printer so that he can send us the programs. That's part of another battle, and you know what I am talking about. And it's a battle that cannot be abandoned. We have to be aware of the resources that are available and claim our rightful part of that, because a lot of that is also bought with our money. We pay taxes. That's part of my money, what they're using. And we will have to learn the strategy to demand more and participate of our rightful share.
I agree with you when you said that it's very important to have the children. Now, I'm a product of the Depression, and I remember I grew up in Greenwich Village, where every Friday we had the theater right in front of the Arc. And the whole neighborhood went there. And we would sit on the floor, an old, I'm Italian, myself married to a Puerto Rican, Virginia's his cousin. And we went there, and the children loved it. The old people, whether they understood it or not, loved the theater. But you know, television has interrupted a lot of stuff. You know, there was nothing in those days. You couldn't afford to go to the movies. But everyone went to these theaters week after week, and it was filled. That park was filled with people sitting on the floor. And it's true that you have to start the interest from when you're small. And all the plays that we saw were all related to the period of the Depression and all the writers of that time. So there was something that everybody could relate to.
Mm-hmm.
But television has a big interference, and you know, for entertainment, a lot, that was the big major entertainment of that time. But you got
well,
to get
the
children
now.
From when they're small.
Yeah, the internet is doing it.
Yeah.
There was a question.
My question was, other than going to the theater, what else can we do to make the New York Puerto Rican theater successful?
Pardon me?
other than going to the theater, to the Puerto Rican theater, what else can we do to make it successful?
You can also go to the theater.
No,
I know what you're saying.
Well, what else can we do?
Donations.
I mean, is there like...
what more can we do?
Yeah, what more? Because I just wonder...
I think somebody...
You can donate money. You can donate money. You can donate time. Sometimes when we have to send out a mailing list of 10,000 people and we don't have the people to put the... I mean, it takes your fingerprints off your fingers. You know, it's like you are... it takes time and we don't have money to pay people to do that. So sometimes you stay in the theater 5 nights completing a 10,000 mailing list postcards. So you can donate time, you can donate money, you can visit the websites, and you can send links to other people you think might be interested.
I just want to sort of underline that. And first, thank Miriam and Eva and Virginia for this wonderful conversation, which is really valuable. Two things stand out from the conversation among all of the wonderful things that were mentioned. One has to do with the competition that the theater now faces. You know, television, internet, the movies. There's a whole host of entertainment options that people in the community have. So we now think of ourselves as consumers with many choices. So one of the things that we have to sort of reflect on is, why aren't more people going to the theater? Well, for one thing, we tend to think that the Latino consumer market really consolidated only in the 90s. It's a really relatively recent thing. And there hasn't been consciousness raising about going back to the cultural institutions, to the standalone arts and cultural institutions. And then to your question, what can you do for them? So first you have to sort of raise the awareness, raise the visibility of organizations like the PRTT, like Sánchez-Korrol. And then you have to find creative ways to participate. If we look at the theater field as a whole, you'll find that grant making isn't the lion's share of the money for the institutions at large. It's individual donations that are the lion's share. And organizations of color, cultural institutions of color, including, of course, our Puerto Rican institutions, have not historically brought in the individual donors as a big part of their budgets. So that I think the responsible thing to do, in addition to buying the ticket, is making sure you make that annual donation, you know, to the organizations that are in your community. Because you're the only ones who are gonna, now it's, when we talk about budget cuts, we're talking about budget cuts in that area that is sustaining what is there, which is grant making from private sources, grant making from government. So we do need the individual dollars to boost it back up. So I think.
And also for you, I'm gonna insist in the thing of visiting the website, figure out who we are, because we exist, we are there, we've been producing, we've been offering things, but if people don't consume them, we are gonna disappear. That is very basic. So there's theater for children in Spanish, and I'm an advocate for theater in Spanish because it's the only thing. I mean, I love the idea of doing also bilingual and in English, but in Spanish is something that is always under the threat of disappearing because schools cut programs in language, students are also, well, it's schools, colleges are doing the same thing. It's like whenever they review, I'm in the Foreign Council for Foreign Languages, in the CUNY Council for Foreign Languages, and they are reviewing how many credits of foreign languages people should be taking, and they are cutting that too, and that's cutting an important part of our audience. If we want to survive, we have to also help the whole community. It's not only the theater, it's the theater, it's when it's music, it's when it's education. We have to support the whole system.
I also think that another way that you can contribute, we are going through an experience at this moment in which a volunteer has come in to help the Puerto Rican Traveling Theater. He's a man from a Wall Street firm. And the chairman of our board, I don't know where she found him, but somebody told her that she was gonna get him this man. He's a young man, he's an Irish man. He's married to a Puerto Rican, I have never met his wife. He's coming to our lives less than 5 months ago. And he's a genius with numbers. So he is helping us now to do our first 1 year budget day to day, moment by moment, second by second reality of where we are. And believe me, it's frightening. We've never gone through that experience. And the things that he suddenly reveals to you about yourself and about your strengths and about the dangers and about the holes, it's frightening. It's totally frightening. So I love him. But you can see how, if we were going to get the talent of that man, I don't know that we have any kind of salary scale to get man. You can donate your time. And this man does not come into our office from 2 to 6. This man works from his Wall Street office, and sometimes he meets me or he meets Alexandra after 6. And he gives 2 hours, 3 hours, and this and that. And the cultivation of a man like that is so important for us because we couldn't ever touch him. He's too expensive. But if you are in marketing, if you are in public relations, if you are in advertising, if you know how to do a business plan, if you know how to read a budget, there's so many ways that you can help our institutions, and is very much needed.
Elena? I have more of a historical type of question. You're talking now about theater and that it's hard to find an audience. Years ago, I've read some stuff that, like, more of those, like, vaudeville type theaters that Virginia mentioned were, used to have packed theaters, like, all over the boroughs. I kind of have a two-part question. Did the dramatic theater, which you're involved in your experience and your research, did they ever cross over people from the dramatic theater to the vaudeville theater? And if they were so popular, why did they sort of fade away? I mean, they're here, you see them here and there in a Brooklyn theater and a Bronx theater, but it sort of faded away, but they were very popular at the time. Do you know, was there a crossover, and why did they sort of fade away?
There was a crossover. There was a crossover in terms of the people that would do vaudeville, would go and do, dramatic bits in plays. There were fewer theaters, so you had less competition for a growing community that was eager to have that cultural experience. But what happened to Spanish language vaudeville is the same thing that happened to English speaking vaudeville. It disappears because of movies. Once movies come in and theaters begin to turn themselves into strictly doing movies, then that was it. And so we have Academy Awards this weekend. With some Latino actors and actresses that are making it. I want to say that we are, want to tell you that we have filmed this entire session to keep it as a resource here in the library and archives. And what I was thinking as we were talking, that certainly one of the things that we should be doing, Alberto, is putting this out on YouTube or something that people see so that they get into this discussion. It's very, very difficult to get this kind of work on CUNY TV, for example, because their programming is so limited. But we should be exploring other avenues to take these videotaped sessions, video recorded sessions, and to show them to a wider audience, because I think that what we heard today was not only the looking at the theater through the eyes of two women who have done so much in the theater, we really learned so much about the entire business of theater that I am very, very much aware now of the problems that you're facing. And I'm thinking to myself, well, one of the things that I would never do is like, I would never approach a Miriam Colón because she's too famous. You know, how could I go to her theater and say I'm a volunteer? But you're saying we could do this.
Of course.
Yes.
And this is, but I think that my attitude is not unusual. I think a lot of people feel that. Even our
Doesn't
want to approach him. But anyway, this was something that I think has given us a license to intervene.
I guess that most of us see also ourselves as educators. It's not just actors, actresses, and producers, mm-hmm. playwrights, and directors. I guess that many of us believe in theater as a very important tool for education, and we advocate for that. And part of getting that agenda through, to see it through, mm-hmm. is going and talk to people, and of course, that's what we do. That's another way. If you cannot come and see a play, at least you get to know that we know that we exist.
Yeah, but the other problem is that, like Miriam was saying, I mean, she's not going to be there forever. She needs somebody that will take over that theater and will keep it going. And like the example that I gave about Intar, it's gone. I mean, I would have loved to have that theater continue and have somebody that will, you know, make a lot of money, and they would be able to hire a fantastic artistic director and a management director, so that the continuation would keep going and they will become an institution. Right now, none of our theaters, I mean, I don't know about maybe Pregones, will have somebody to continue that. What happens when you are gone?
Succession.
I guess you have to have, you have to be open to also, as you are working, welcoming a newer generation and training them to stay when you're not there. You have to train them. And now we have many things that we didn't used to have. We have people who are studying arts management, things that other companies had to have the actors do the management, which is, I don't know how to manage money, so why would I be managing the money of a whole company and the salaries of other people? So now we have people who are more, more trained than we were, and who have careers that would nourish what we are doing. But we also, I guess, that at some point, you have to say, okay, I'm not gonna be here forever, so let me see from all these people who are working with us, who can I train? Not only give away what
we let go of
something that you did. Es como dar un niño ya criado.
Yeah, but we tried.
You're not gonna give away a kid that you raised.
I don't
want to
be negative, but we had tried when we were in the theater to train other people that would be as committed as we were, and somehow it didn't work.
Yes.
I want to go back to an image that you said today, Eva, that was so amazing for me, which was you said you go back home to Puerto Rico and you clean your mother's house. You have a domestic life there. There was that's your home. You're not a visitor. And I think if we can apply that same image to our lives and how we connect with our cultural institutions here in New York, that you're not just an educator or someone who's working with an educational institution, but someone who lives in a community here in New York and who can say, this is my theater. This is my cultural institution. I don't just go there to see a play, because that's very passive. And we love for you to come to our theaters, but that's very passive. I love when we have people, volunteers, that come and say, but this is my home also. This is where I choose to partake of art. Therefore, I have an opinion. I have contacts. I have ideas that I can share with you. We have a wonderful group of volunteers that I consider them the most sophisticated, educated people in the world. And I don't think they even have high school education. But, you know, they go to every single cultural event in this city because they say, this is where I clean my house. This is where I go. And they come and they stuff our envelopes. And they stay there like, you know, day in or day out, but they know that this is something that is essential for them. So if you have a class, it's not just taking your students to come see the theater, instilling in them that theater is essential part of their lives, of our legacy in our communities. And that in that, you're going to create, plant the seeds of the people that are going to, again, continue to support, you know, these institutions. I remember when we went to Alfred University, 6 years ago. And we did a show, like we always do, and we had these workshops. And we had this young man, a Puerto Rican from the Bronx, who was studying Alfred all the way up there, El Frio. And his jaw just dropped. And he followed us the entire week we were there. He even cut classes. What are you doing now? Where are you going now? Let me talk to you. I want to hear more about you. That young man, I said to him, you know, he said, you know, I think I want to do theater. And I said, well, when you finish, you can come back. The day after he graduated from Alfred, what did he do? He came almost with his suitcases to our door. He knocked. He said, I'm here. You know? Now he's one of the younger members of our company, and he's working as an actor here in New York. But he saw that as something that is part of his life.
But how in many terms, of those do you see interested in management?
It's up to
the group.
But I think that's our task then, is to ignite in people the idea that this is not just a theater to go be entertained.
Because everybody wants to be an actress,
you know.
And everybody wants to
in
be
terms
an
of Intar, I want to clarify that Intar is alive. It's not the same as it was before, but it's alive and well and alive. The director there is one of the directors, Carmelita Tropicana. And they're having a really interesting project right now with new playwrights. And they're still around, and they're still working. It's different, and that's what's going to happen with our institutions.
Yes.
They're going to change, and they're going to evolve, like our children. You know, they don't do the same things that we do, but they do things that are going to teach us about what's happening today. So those things grow and they change, but we have to make sure that we understand that it is your participation in our theaters that are going to keep it alive. Not just coming to see the show, but actually seeing them as your homes. So, I don't know, makes any sense.
I can't help but just think back when you were saying you were looking for someone that's committed to the theater. I was reading an article, I don't know, from the doctor's office, or one of those articles that you pick up when you're bored waiting for something. And it was in reference to commitment in the workforce. And when I started working in 1978, the commitment was that you were going to commit yourself to wherever you worked, the industry where you worked at, until you retired. And now that philosophy has changed. So you're here for 3 years, and then you're here for another 5 years, because the economy and the commitment is no longer what it used to be when I was younger. So do you find that that's going to affect the theater trying to find a person that's as committed as you are? I think it's also a group of people that no longer have that type of commitment. You know how that like the Maria Sanchez, the battle of the chairperson of Puerto Rican Studies at Brooklyn College was committed to that. I don't know if we have those type of people that commit that way.
Right.
So and it has to do with the economy, of course, since you are forced to move here and there.
It has to do with the economy, but it also has to do with what is instilled inside you, in terms of the pride in being who you are and coming from where you come. I think more work has to be done in that department. The recognition of our uniqueness, of the fact that we are different, of the fact that we do not have to respond to the most popular type, the appearance and this and that, that there is beauty and in our being different, that being different is not a sin, and you don't have to apologize for it. But there would be some way to instill more of that into our children. If it would be somehow a little room left for the fact that they call this the melting pot, but that was a reality of other years, and that you can still be loyal to what you believe this country is. You can still be a loyal person, but you can defend your difference and your uniqueness. You don't have to apologize for that. When you have done a little bit of that, then it somehow starts working on, oh, but they don't know some of the men and women that helped to make the Latinos, that helped to make this country what it is today. The contributions that they made through the years to the history of this country. What Latinos have done through the world, that emphasis somehow if it could be enriched in the minds of our students, if somehow we could convince this educational system that is spending so many millions, possibly billions, in the education of our children, if we could convince them to include some of the essence of those students that in some neighborhoods sometimes amount to almost half of the student population. To spend all these millions and not put some kind of safeguards that if at the end of this period I'll give you 1 million, but here's 500,000. And you will have the other 500,000 later on. If at the end of the 500,000, those children cannot read, those children cannot write, those children has not progressed 2%, you lose the other 500,000. But to just give money like that without any restriction, well, I hope something good happens from it. But some safeguards must be put in defense of our children.
I think accountability is a good word for that.
Mm-hmm.
Miriam, Eva, I want to thank you.
Thank you.
I want to thank you.